Hi guys, Dave with First Place Auto Parts. Thanks for joining me in the studio today. You know, today's product we're going to look at is something that you probably use every day. As a matter of fact, some of you probably use it in large quantities. It doesn't matter if you own an American muscle car or a late model car or truck. Maybe you own a boat or just some lawn equipment to take care of the property around your home. Today we're going to take a look at gasoline, and more specifically, ethanol gasoline. Look, ethanol gas is here to stay, and it's federally mandated by law that the U.S. use up to 36 billion gallons of fuel a year of ethanol gas by the year 2022. So that can be accomplished one of two ways. Either we use more gas, which is unlikely. Look, we're already using a lot of gas as a nation, or they increase the level of ethanol in our actual fuel, which is what E85 ethanol fuel tries to accomplish. And if you're like me and you're not really ready to either A, give up on the internal combustion engine, or B, plug your car into a wall every day before you want to drive it to work, we have to learn to cope with ethanol fuel. Like I said earlier, it's here to stay. And to do that, we have to understand the unique makeup of ethanol fuel and also the ramifications that it has for vehicles that were made before 2002 and for some vehicles as late as 2011. Hey guys, if you liked today's video, please consider subscribing to the First Place Auto Parts YouTube channel. We're going to continually be adding new videos every week where we show you how to put new parts on, we take a look at the latest parts that are available, and we go to some pretty cool car guy stuff I'm pretty sure you're going to want to see. So when we talk about ethanol fuel in today's pumps, really we're talking about one of two different types of fuel. One is called E10 and the other is called E85. E10 is your traditional ethanol fuel. It is comprised of a mixture of 90% gasoline and 10% ethanol fuel to make the E10. Now the other product called E85 is a totally different animal. It can have anywhere from 50 to 83% ethanol in it, and the remainder is traditional gasoline. So if your vehicle is not rated as a flex fuel rating, it cannot use E85. E85 is another level of ethanol fuel that is not made for every vehicle. Just be aware of that. Here in the United States, ethanol is made out of grain alcohol, traditionally made from corn. Of course, in other countries, it can be made from many different things, including switchgrass, manure, willow trees, and even cane sugar. And now that we understand really what ethanol gas is and what the different types are, let's look at the pros and cons of ethanol fuel. And we're going to look at the pros list first because it's quite honestly, it's a pretty short list. And the first pro that everyone's going to point to is that it is a cleaner burning fuel. Now look, this does not mean that it's a clean burning fuel. It just means it's cleaner than traditional gasoline. And the other is the octane rating tends to be a little higher. Now, the octane rating thing is kind of interesting to hot rodders and performance guys. And I can tell you this, that my 1956 Chevrolet has a big block in it that runs about 10.5:1 compression ratio and has iron heads. Now, when I run traditional 90 octane premium, which is all we can really get at the pumps anymore, short of going to racing gas, I'll get a lot of detonation with this motor, even with timing retarded. However, when I run the 93 octane ethanol fuel in this car, it runs great all the time. No knock, full timing, it runs fantastic. I have no fear of detonation with the ethanol fuel. So ethanol does have some benefits in regards to performance. Alcohol tends to burn a little cooler as well, which can also slow down the burn in the combustion chamber. There's actually some classes that actually run ethanol only type cars or carburation or fuel system. So performance guys, there are some benefits to this, but you absolutely have to adjust for ethanol fuel if you're going to run it with regularity in an earlier carbureted vehicle. And the second pro that everyone's going to want to point to, and it's fact, is that the ethanol part of the fuel is made from renewable sources. Sure, the topic of taking corn from the field, from the table, to make gasoline and the government subsidies that come with it, it's for another discussion. But the reality is that the ethanol fuel, or the ethanol part of fuel, is absolutely a green and renewable resource and isn't completely made from dead dinosaurs. And now for the negatives of ethanol fuel, and that is the very first one, is that ethanol fuel has 34% less energy than the traditional gas. Not only that, that adds up to approximately 3 miles per gallon less per gallon in the average vehicle on American roads today. Now look, that's a big deal. It's going to take more ethanol fuel to go the same distance as it would with traditional gas for what we call pure gas. So that's a huge difference. It's not as efficient at burning as traditional gas is. And also it's going to completely change things like air fuel mixtures, right? Your main jets, your idle feeds, all those things have to be changed with the more ethanol percentage you go up with. So E10 requires a tweak to the air fuel ratio. E85, forget about it. That's a whole nother story. You're really talking about re-engineering a carburetor to be able to run E85. But ethanol fuel is not nearly as efficient as pure gas is. The second negative is that ethanol fuel is hygroscopic, and what that means is that it absorbs water out of the air much more readily than what traditional gasoline does. Look, most of this fuel system in early classic vehicles were made out of metal. Steel gas tanks, steel fuel lines, there's fittings in the carburetor that are metal as well. Water in your gas has never been a good thing, and it's even more so important now. Water and condensation form not only scale, but also rust that developed, which will break loose eventually and plug up the small orifices and not only carburetors, but potentially also fuel injection units. So it's something that this water thing is a bad deal. Also, water tends to swell the traditional paper that was in a fuel filter. So your older fuel filters that had paper, pleated paper in them, they'll tend to swell. And what that does is it cuts down and down the flow of the fuel to the car. Now in a carburetor, what that means is the car runs leaner. You may get drivability issues with that. So collection of water or the absorption of water from the air is the second biggest problem with ethanol fuel. And the third con of ethanol-based fuel, and this one's bitten me a bunch, is that it actually is a solvent. And being a solvent, it does one of two things. One, it attacks rubber, plastic, and fiberglass, makes it either very brittle to where it'll break and doesn't seal anymore, or it'll actually eat a hole in fiberglass, say you have a fiberglass tank on a vintage motorcycle. But number two is the solvent will actually break loose rust and any kind of deposits in your fuel system and send them upstream to the carburetor or the fuel injection. So this stuff being a solvent, and the more ethanol you add, like with the E85 stuff, the more solvents you have in your fuel. So it creates huge issues. Like I said, for me, it's manifested itself not only in fuel lines, but stuff that doesn't even carry fuel, but that has fuel vapors. Things like vacuum lines coming from the carburetor, or our PCV valve lines that come from a carburetor. Anything that has to do with or is around the fumes of ethanol gets affected. So that's a big one. Look, that can be a hazardous thing. We're talking about something that's carrying fuel. And when you, if and when you spring a leak and it's on top of a hot engine, ultimately that can mean a fire. So keep an eye on your plastic and rubber lines if you're running E10 fuel in your classic American muscle car. Fortunately, there are some remedies to protect yourself and your vehicle and your equipment from the effects of ethanol fuel damage. And the first one is there are currently a lot of products, rubber fuel line, vacuum lines, carburetor gaskets, and O-rings that are made that are ethanol compatible. Upgrading those components will go a long way to prevent leaks and also drivability issues down the road. The second thing is, make sure that you find an ethanol-compatible fuel conditioner and use it with regularity, especially if a vehicle sits for a long time. Not all fuel treatments are ethanol-compatible, so make sure you read the label before you get one. Next, keep your gas tanks full, especially if your vehicle or your piece of equipment sits for a long time. By reducing that airspace in the fuel tank, you reduce the opportunity for condensation to build up, which is where the water is going to come from. And finally, your final option is to use pure gas, especially for your lawn equipment, or if you have something that sits for a long time, or you have a boat. This gas is typically called either REC 90, which is a 90-octane non-ethanol fuel. It can be called pure gas. It can be called a lot of different things, but you're finding these gas pumps more and more. It'll be a separate gas pump. It won't be with the other gas pumps. Don't confuse the two, but you can find pure gas around the country without difficulty. As a matter of fact, there's a website called Pure Gas. I think it's puregas.org. It'll actually find you by state where pure gas is available. So you just put in your zip code, it pulls up where a gas station is nearby, and you can go buy it there. But especially if when you have vehicles that sit for a long time, make sure that you use pure gas if you can. It's a little expensive or more expensive. It doesn't have the same subsidies that ethanol fuel does from the government, but it's well worth it when it comes time to starting that vehicle and using it again, especially after it's sat for a while. There's no question that ethanol fuel is here to stay. As a matter of fact, the percentage of ethanol to regular gas is going to continue to increase. If they ever do enact the E85 at all of our pumps, the reality is if you own a car that's a 2011 and older, you're going to have to do something with your fuel system to make sure it's compatible with ethanol fuel, especially at the increasing levels at which it looks like we're headed. Do those things today and you protect yourself against whatever they come out with tomorrow. Guys, I appreciate you watching this video. Hopefully you found it informative. And until next time, keep the hammer down and keep it between the guardrails.